Something Dragon Ball always did well were the one-sided fights, whether it was just for comedy, like Bear Thief vs. Goku or Kami vs. Yamcha, or had a meaning behind it, like Yamcha vs. Jackie Chun or Tambourine vs., well, everyone, they were always well done, despite being short. When the series shifted to the Z era, it became more known for the fights that were in it for the long haul. However, the one-sided fights were still prominent, they just got overshadowed sometimes by the bigger boss fights, and I want to give them the attention they deserve. I still consider a fight one-sided when the other side can fight back, but they don't do much notable damage in the grand scheme of things, and the character delivering the beatdown essentially has no trouble. The biggest factor I'm considering is the story impact behind the fight, but I'll still be looking at fights that were played off just for laughs like classic Dragon Ball. Now with the rules set, let's commence the top 10 one-sided fights in Dragon Ball Z. Number 10, Krillin vs. Pintar. Before we get into the more serious fights, we're starting with a fun one. I really like the Buu Saga, especially the first half, and this fight had that classic Dragon Ball flair. This fight felt like the preliminary matches of the tournament arcs when the comedically large characters were knocked down by the tiny fighters. Pintar was set up to make it satisfying to see him knocked down. He showboats before doing anything, smack talks before the tournament up until him and Krillin enter the ring, and allows Krillin to get the first punch in since he thinks it's an easy win. He also makes fun of Krillin for being short, and I'm like, come on man, he made it to top 16 with you, does that really matter? And through all of this, Krillin has just had it with the world and looks completely uninterested. Of course, letting Krillin get the first punch in leads to a total defeat, which would have happened regardless, but it gave us the entertaining visual of a nonchalant beatdown where Krillin knocks him out with his eyes closed. The quote-unquote fight is just long and varied enough for me to consider this a fight. The slaps in the middle of everything are what make it so great. The indifference of Krillin being like, woo, yeah, go team, as he walks off the ring as the bow on top of this fight. Though, the flashbacks of Pintar actually fighting made me want to see a side story of all the tournaments without the main cast. Do Pintar and the other normal fighters that we met fight like Girin or Bacterian, or are they just a bunch of generic fighters like Panput? Number 9, Frieza vs. Nail. From the major Frieza fight on Namek, it never really felt overwhelmingly one-sided. Don't get me wrong, Frieza could have killed them all effortlessly, except maybe Goku if he wanted to, but he preferred to hold back to mess with the Z fighters, or as the dub liked to say a lot, he's toying with us! Vegeta could hold his own until Frieza's transformation, Gohan could survive in Rage mode, Piccolo had the advantage until Frieza turned into a Xenomorph, and Krillin took advantage of Frieza's hubris by running away, with strategy, and got hit by the cheap shot. So my final verdict is, these fights were in some sort of gray area. They were artificially not one-sided. However, the one Frieza fight on Namek that gets eclipsed by the big fight is his fight against Nail. Above any of the techniques that we see, I really like the implications this fight has about Nail. He knows he can't win, we all know he can't win, but being the most elite Namekian warrior, he knows how vital it is to keep Frieza busy while the rest of the crew gathers the Dragon Balls so Frieza can't use them. It's one of the most modest displays of bravery in the whole series. With the fight itself, you get to see some pretty cool techniques from Nail. You have the staple super explosive wave in that one move where Nail is all worn out and Frieza's like, ya done? And Nail is like, shut up! And does a seamless turnaround massive blast. Of course, this all amounts to nothing as Frieza is unharmed, but I loved how the attacks looked while they were happening, especially the latter one. On the other side of things, all of Frieza's attacks do massive damage on each hit, and considering the list topic, he only needs to land a few hits. Even though we barely got to see his power, Frieza shows off his signature arrogance with these strikes, particularly the casual arm rip and that punch where he doesn't even need to turn around. All in all, a good show from each side, despite the lopsided results. A shame Nail's techniques could not be used in a more victorious fashion, but maybe one day Piccolo can revive his unnamed turnaround blast attack. Number 8, Vegeta vs. Android 19. You almost feel bad for Android 19 here. He was completely misled on how he'd fare in in this fight. He was on equal footing with Goku, but only because of his heart virus. So 19 thought, oh, all Saiyans must be this weak. Then Vegeta allowed him to get a few hits in for free, making 19 even more smug. Now that he was built up, Vegeta actually started fighting, and it was embarrassing for 19. Vegeta beat him like a punching bag, while 19 fails to even land a hit. Vegeta then has a throwback to earlier in the fight and stands completely still to let 19 think he has a chance. 19 starts to do his energy drain technique, only for Vegeta to tear away any hope from him, literally. I like that it looks like Vegeta still has to put a bit of effort into tearing his arms off, or he just wanted to relish in the humiliation factor. Did he really need the feet on face momentum, or could he have just ripped them off without the showmanship? He kinda looks like a kid having fun at something on the playground when doing it. 19 tries to retreat on foot, but where did he think he could run off to? You know these guys can fire energy beams at light speeds, you would have been better off playing dead in the ditch again. This fight was fun because we got to see Vegeta at peak arrogance with no repercussions. I do like seeing Vegeta taken down a peg when he deserves it, but I think it was fine here. Plus, Big Bang Attack generally gets overshadowed by Vegeta's various beams, so it's nice to see it finish off a fight. Number 7, Tenshinhan vs. Nappa. This is a non-traditional fight, since the final action of it occurs after the next fight starts, but I really like the emotion behind this exchange. A lot of people I know just start with Z on the Saiyan Saga rather than watching Dragon Ball first, and it really takes away from the impact of this fight. Considering Tien was one of the top fighters just one arc before this with the Piccolo Jr. arc and the main line of defense against Piccolo Daimao when Goku was away, it showed the threat level of the Saiyans when he was getting tossed around with ease. Tien could barely hold his own against Nappa, though Nappa got a cheap shot in by breaking off Tien's hand without warning. Even so, once they started fighting one-on-one, I feel Tien would have been overwhelmed with or without the injury. The main part of the fight starts after Chiaotzu blows himself up and attempts to take Nappa with him, but to no avail. Motivated by his best buddy sacrificing himself and Nappa treating him like trash after he's gone, Tien gets even more fueled by rage. The issue is, he's not his usual calm and collected self here, so he's fighting without thinking. Nappa blocks everything, and when he lays a few hits on Tien, Tien's down almost instantly. It's a fall from grace that you hate to see, but at least the fight ends with a big moment. After Nappa spends some time fighting Krillin and Piccolo, Tien gets up to add the delayed exclamation point on their fight by firing the strongest Kikoho that he can at Nappa, and he blocks it. If it wasn't anticlimactic, then it wouldn't have been on this list. But it really makes Tien feel like a mini Shakespearean tragedy in how he tried so hard and got so far, but in the end, Linkin Park lyrics defined him. As sad as it was to see, it was a great storytelling method in making us feel the futility of winning against the Saiyans, though they did not need to sacrifice Tien's relevancy in doing so. Number 6, Videl vs. Spopovich. This fight is generally hard to watch, but it was a notable turning point in the Buu saga, and unfortunately, it was the last big moment Videl got. The fight itself is brutal. Videl gets plenty of strong hits and rushes in, which would have done damage to Spopovich if he wasn't steroided up on Bobbity's magic. Sadly though, he was just inadvertently pulling the whole rope-a-dope strategy. Videl got tired out since Spopovich has unlimited stamina or something like that with the magic, and Spopovich then went in for the kill over and over and over again. Spopovich has no real technique, so it's a display of brutality that hits harder for the viewer knowing Videl is this up-and-coming fighter, and she's getting pummeled at a more intense level compared to many of the tournament matches we saw in Dragon Ball. Comparing it to the tournaments, I feel like this has the same brutality level as the Goku vs. Piccolo Jr. fight, which says something about the level of pain Videl had to endure considering that was a fight between what we thought was a demon and a man trained by God. This fight was also a massive tonal shift from the other fights we just saw leading up to it. Krillin vs. Pintar was only like a few minutes before this, the lightheartedness was all gone. I think those factors ultimately contribute to why this fight is not the most popular. They give Spopovich a backstory on how Mr. Satan, her father, humiliated him in a previous tournament, and that's why he's specifically so violent towards her. I appreciate that they made him more than just a simple Hulk smash character, but it still doesn't move my sympathy meter towards him. I think the groundwork for this fight could have worked. It could have been like the Yamcha versus Jackie Chun fight in the first tournament arc, where Yamcha was built up to have trained during the time gap and then was defeated easily by Roshi in disguise to show us that life is unfair and you must stay motivated. Yamcha's fight in the next tournament may have ended in the first round again, but it was a much more valiant effort and showed character growth from his previous loss. If Videl used this as a stepping stone and was able to hold her own the next time she got a chance to fight some mystical villain, I think this loss would have been worthwhile. However, she never even gets a chance to fight after this to show the growth that could have come from this. Who was the next villain she even met? Super Boo? It would have been cool if she could have at least stood up to one of Bobbity's henchmen if she tagged along on the trip to Bobbity's spaceship. Alas, she was relegated to pure side character duties after this, much to our dismay. The other missed opportunity was not having the tournament progress past the next fight before being interrupted. I would have loved to see it advance to top 8 so Gohan could reverse the beatdown on Spopovich. You could still propel the Boo storyline by having something like Yamu getting the jump on Gohan when he's distracted by rage in that fight. There are a few other factors that would have had to change if that were to happen, but overall, I wish the Videl versus Spopovich fight could have been some sort of starting point for Videl's character arc rather than her final effort. Number 5, Majin Buu versus Gohan and the Supreme Kai. I love the intro we got to Buu. It was a total subversion from the expected and I was all in for it. Though Toriyama really made Buu's power in his first fight eclipse how silly he was. I like that Buu's resilience to any attack was visually explained. His body was made of this indescribable bouncy goo that we had never seen before that made it seem like he could absorb any hit. When Gohan kicked his face in, it just popped out. It added more personality to his imperviousness than just being that villain that stands there unfazed. There was now a sense of wonder to how his body worked. Once Buu emerged, he had 3 major fights in a row. One versus Gohan and Shin the Supreme Kai, one versus Deborah, and one versus Vegeta. I feel the Gohan and Shin fight had the biggest feeling of hopelessness to it and set the stage for Buu being a serious threat. As soon as Buu intercepts them, he smashes Gohan into the ground, leaving Shin to fight alone for a bit. For this god, we may have been expecting some incredibly mighty power, but it's hard to tell based on Buu's reaction to his attacks. Buu just gets pushed back by Shin's psychic eye stuff as if it were a small breeze, and that's essentially all Shin can do. One time Buu even retaliates by doing the same attack back, foreshadowing that he can mimic abilities, and it looks a lot more terrifying when he does it. A big thing about the one-sidedness of this fight is how playful Buu can be. He does most of his damage on Shin with this fun-looking clap attack. Even though it doesn't sound threatening, Shin looks like a wreck afterwards. You would have thought he endured more punches based on his appearance, but Buu is just that strong. And when Buu recovers from being hit later on, he doesn't just sit back up unharmed, he does a cartwheel. However, he's also good at transitioning from innocent to terrifying, since that blast he hits Gohan with shortly after all these shenanigans looks devastating. It's not so much based on the size of the blast, but Gohan's reactions. That is the look of intense pain, and his screams say it all too. This is where the visuals can really sell how strong the beatdown is, and that's basically the fight. While Vegeta gets the bigger Buu fight in the string of fights, I think the Gohan-Shin fight really sets the stage for the terrors and surprises of Majin Buu. Number 4, Vegeta versus Perfect Cell. I was conflicted about this one, since if you consider Vegeta's fight with Semi-Perfect Cell as part of the overall Vegeta versus Cell fight, then it was sort of even, with Vegeta dominating Semi-Perfect Cell and then Perfect Cell embarrassing Vegeta. However, I consider them different battles, since Vegeta essentially forfeited against Semi-Perfect Cell once he heard he had a more powerful form and then reset the battle from the beginning once Cell was perfect. This was the kind of fight where Vegeta deserved his beatdown. A lot of people blame Krillin for not blowing up 18 to prevent Cell from absorbing her, but Vegeta was so fervent on stopping Trunks from pursuing Cell, who was pursuing 18, he might have just destroyed the remote if he saw Krillin had it. So I'm on team Vegeta messed up here. For a fight with so many iconic moments, I'm surprised it was as one-sided as it turned out to be. It's mostly a lot of smack talk from both sides, and Vegeta doing some fancy attacks with no results. results. He both starts and ends the fight with the continuous Ki Blast Barrage, which has the standard DBZ result where the recipient is standing there unharmed after the dust clears. He also does a useless kick that's so good they showed in a flashback a few minutes later. Oh, but this is the fight where he does Final Flash for the first time, so he must hold his own pretty well. Oh wait, Cell's fine. He fakes this out a little by showing the beam removed half his body, but then he waits 5 seconds to be all, "Huh, fooled you, I'm fine, I can regenerate." At least Cell was nice enough to let Vegeta put on a show. As for Cell's retaliation, it was only a few hits, but that's all he needed. I like the simplicity. He casually punches Vegeta in the face as he walks through his energy barrage, hits him up, and then hits him down. We spent like an hour watching Vegeta do stuff, so Cell wanted to keep it brief. Number 3, the Vegeta vs. Zarbon doubleheader. These fights went the opposite ways, so I'm going to consider them ties or parallels. Either way, the first fight was all Zarbon's. Vegeta got some easy hits on him before we knew Zarbon could transform in the first fight, but it was nothing where I'd say Vegeta was evenly matched right away. As soon as Zarbon transformed, he went right in. There was no transition. Hey, I'm powered up now, knee to the gut, and then he combos with some other brute force attacks. This is actually one of my favorite fights because Zarbon does what a top henchman should do and his moves are entertaining. He finds his target, transforms as soon as he gets a chance, and completely overpowers them. The beatdown itself was actually pretty realistic in terms of fighting style. It was very pro wrestling. He had headbutts, pile drivers, spinning throws, the works. It could have fit into one of the tournament arcs from Dragon Ball. Throwing Vegeta to the bottom of a lake and flying off was a bit careless since they always get away when you leave them to die and no one's watching, but this time it probably would have worked. The only reason this came back to bite Zarbon is because Frieza demanded that he get Vegeta since he knew the locations of one of the Dragon Balls, which means the intervention likely is the only reason Vegeta survived. By recovering Vegeta from the bottom of the lake and healing him, he enables a Zenkai boost for Vegeta, which is when Saiyans get a power and strength boost whenever they're beaten to near death and recover, so it's all over for Zarbon in the rematch. When confronting Vegeta after he escapes, Zarbon screws around a bit by not transforming right away, but even when he does, it's pretty embarrassing for him. Vegeta pulls out the most effective attack against Zarbon, Pocket Sand. Ki Blasts are nothing if they don't get in your eyes. Anyway, Zarbon gets hit around, grabs Vegeta thinking he's about to pull a reversal, and then Vegeta impales and blasts through Zarbon, killing him. He may have been disposed of easily in the rematch, but you have to give him props for that first fight. Those moves he showed off are still why I want to see him in a formal fighting game someday. Number 2, Gohan vs. Raccoon. This falls under the same category as the Videl vs. Spopovich fight, where it can get hard to watch, but it holds a lot of meaning, mostly for Gohan's character development. Even though Gohan is half Saiyan, you have to remember that this is a 5-year-old kid at this point in the series. He's barely developed his personality, yet he's already making life-threatening decisions and fighting fully grown dudes. When Gohan starts to fight Raccoon, I thought this was going to be a David vs. Goliath match, where Gohan holds his own enough. He was set up perfectly. Vegeta was about to lose, Krillin gets a sneak attack on Raccoon to stop him, but is out of commission after Raccoon retaliates, and Gohan is the only uninjured fighter left. It starts with Raccoon evading Gohan, but it turns brutal fast. When he's not going for Ki Blast barrages, he's going with physical force, and a lot of it. He doesn't care about Gohan's age or size, he hits hard. The impact when Gohan hits the ground looks painful, and Gohan never backs down. Gohan would not stop fighting until one of them could not move. When Gohan enters rage mode, it looks like we're finally going to see a worthwhile turn in the tides, but Raccoon easily pops out of it and gives him a pity compliment before hitting him many meters away. He even blows away one of Gohan's beams like dandelion fluff floating in the air. The final subversion of expectations was when Gohan gets up after all of this to rush Raccoon, thinking we'd finally see a comeback, only for Raccoon to gently float above him and deliver the final almost neck-breaking kick. The look of pain pain and defeat on Gohan's face was even enough to make Vegeta be like, that was pretty messed up. Overall, it showed a new level of Gohan's bravery and resilience, but I wish the fight could have been a little more even. Gohan didn't deserve this, he's a good boy. Luckily, Goku just arrived after all this to heal everyone and have a one-sided fight of his own against Raccoon, if you can call that a fight. For number one, this was simply the fight that felt the best considering the topic. It had some cool moves, comedy, subversion, iconic characters, so why not? Number one, Trunks vs. Frieza and King Cold. Everything about this fight was cool, not just in terms of the attacks, but also the meaning behind it. First off, the fight itself. Since we just saw the Frieza fight, Frieza doesn't need to do too many crazy attacks. We know what he's all about. However, he essentially puts all of his potential attacks into one giant ball. When Trunks' Super Saiyan form enrages him, Frieza goes for the gold right away and makes his biggest death ball possible to finish this up uncharacteristically quickly. To tip the scales even more into Trunks' favor in terms of style, he lifts the planet-destroying blast with his hand and just casually walks it back to Frieza as if it was simply something he dropped. Then Frieza ruins it by detonating the ball, only for Trunks to casually play Death by Disintegration for a second before revealing, "I'm over here!" Trunks closes it out with the famous moment where he slashes Frieza into pieces and then blasts those pieces just to be safe. We already saw him defy death once, so who says he's not gonna do it again? To add to this feat of strength, Frieza's dad, King Cold, pulls the old schoolyard bully tactic of asking to see your toy for a sec and then just taking it. It's fun to see the murderous joy on King Cold's face when he thinks he's about to slash Trunks with his own sword, only to have his happiness dashed when Trunks no-sells him, blasts him once, and then blasts him again for good measure. Game over. As great as the spectacle of the fight is, I love the idea behind it. The big villain comes to Earth for revenge to start off a saga, and he brings his tough-looking dad. It seems like this is going to be a big part of the arc, but no dice. Then this no-name character comes out of nowhere, has the same power-up that Goku had, and takes a mere fraction of the time to beat the final boss of the last arc. The biggest salt in the wound moment is that the dramatic supernova that Frieza used to destroy planet Vegeta was the same one that was effortlessly held back by Trunks. It sends a message to how power creep has affected Frieza. The quick death of King Cold also sends a message and plays like a classic Toriyama gag, but is framed more seriously. This part of the fight felt like Goku beating foes with one punch in Dragon Ball when they were built up to be a serious challenge, like Colonel Silver or Panput. Welcome to the only Dragon Ball video on the internet that mentions Panput twice. A lot of people put King Cold as one of the top wasted potential characters in the Dragon Ball universe, and I cannot really disagree with that. But considering he was designed to subvert our expectations and be a joke overall, I think he served a purpose, even though that purpose was to be useless like a splash attack in Pokemon. And hey, he made for a hell of an introduction for Trunks, showing us that he's more than just a pretty face.
You look so hot there. That doesn't sound right coming out of my mouth. Also, that doesn't sound right with me saying it. That is a very attractive photo of him. He is an attractive man.
Where have you been?
I just came here to talk about Trunks and his beautiful, beautiful hair.
So with the domination and a bit of comedy, Trunks' annihilation of Frieza and his father get him the title of my top one-sided fight in Dragon Ball Z. Now, what did you think? How do these fights rank for you? Which were your favorites, and which one-sided fights that I did not discuss deserve a little more praise for their moves or maybe even humor? Let me know in the comments. Anyway, thank you all for watching, and I will see you in the next video.